A very good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have apologies this morning from Colette Stevenson, and I welcome Jackie Dunbar to the meeting as her substitute. And we've also received apologies from Jamie Green. So our first item of business this morning is to agree to take agenda item 4 on evidence heard today in private. Are we all agreed? Agreed, thank you. So our next item of business is consideration of evidence on the Children, Care and Justice Scotland Bill. And I welcome to the meeting Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, Natalie Dawn, Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise, Katrina Dalrymple, Deputy Director of Community Justice, Tom McNamara, Head of Youth Justice and Children's Hearings, and Barry McCaffrey, Lawyer with the Scottish Government. So a warm welcome to you all. And I'd like to just take this opportunity to welcome both ministers to their new roles and also to thank the former Cabinet Secretary, Keith Brown, for his engagement with the committee over recent years. And I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I intend to allow up to around about 90 minutes for this session. So on that note, I'd like to invite the Cabinet Secretary and or Minister to make some brief opening remarks.
Convener, the Minister will make an opening statement.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you, Convener, and thank you, Committee, for having us here today. I should also thank the witnesses who appeared at your 29th of March evidence session. Scotland and all the parties in this Parliament made a commitment to keeping the promise. One of the Government's stated commitments is to end the placement of children in young offenders' institutions by 2024. The Bill takes forward this part of promise keeping, and it also advances rights under the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. Notably, this bill does not disturb the constitutional independence of the Lord Advocate. Procurators Fiscal will retain the discretion to prosecute young people in court where that is deemed necessary. Independent sentencers in Scotland's courts will still be able to deprive a young person under the age of 18 of their liberty where appropriate. But the bill makes it clear that where a young person under 18 needs to be deprived of their liberty, this should be in secure accommodation rather than in a YOI. So public protection and dealing with any risks of harm to others remain key considerations in the provisions you have before you. Members will also recall that the previous Justice Committee carried out an inquiry into secure care and prison places for children and young people. Their report concluded that no young person under the age of 18 should be placed in Polmont when a place in a secure care unit would be more suitable. Research tells us that children who commit harm are often the very same children that have already been harmed by others. They have often faced multiple trauma and adversity. Those issues need attention in the right setting. As you have heard, YOIs are not primarily designed to be therapeutic environments for children. Secure care centres are specifically designed to be trauma-informed and age-appropriate. They offer a high staff-to-child ratio of skilled professionals to meet the complex needs of young people. When a child is placed in secure care, public protection and safety are critical. Facilities are locked, the supervision and support arrangements in secure centres are intensive. Members can be assured that secure care can, and indeed already does, care for those children who pose the greatest risk of serious harm. I know that stakeholders unanimously express support for ending the placement of children in YOIs, but also express concerns about resourcing. The Scottish Government is already investing in secure care capacity, and a national resourcing and implementation group is due to start this work in early June. Drawing on these evidence sessions, that work will support preparations for financial years 24 to 25 and the years beyond. I hope that these opening remarks have been helpful, and I look forward to answering your questions on the bill.
Thanks very much indeed, Minister. So if I may, as usual, I'll start off questions. And then I'll bring in members. So in your opening remarks, Minister, you mentioned some of the witnesses that we've already heard from and some of the very helpful evidence that we have heard. And I'd like to open up questions looking at the issue around age. So broadly, the provision or one of the main provisions of the bill is that people under the age of 18 are no longer placed in a YOI or even a prison. Now, the committee heard evidence from a range of witnesses that there should perhaps be more scope for an individualised assessment process of a child or a young person to determine whether and where a child or a young person should be detained. And that would be based on factors such as their development, their maturity, perhaps their neurological development. So aside from the issue around resources, are there any other particular barriers to being able to provide an individualised assessment process for children that are entering the criminal justice system and potentially are entering a secure environment?
You know, perhaps start with your specific request in and around children entering the criminal justice system. Mm-hmm. I mean, the reason that I'm the lead cabinet secretary, given my justice portfolio, and the minister is coming from the children and care perspective, is that the bill that's before committee just now is very much about that intersection between how we meet the care needs and uphold the rights of children, but also in the context of the demands and expectations in and around our justice system. And what is imperative that if we as a government and indeed a country are absolutely focused on reducing risk and reducing reoffending amongst young people, we have to start with addressing their care needs, because unless their individual needs are addressed, that will be a barrier to addressing and managing risk. And if we don't address and manage risk, we will not reduce reoffending. So, therefore, it is imperative that both the children's hearing system and in particular the court system has the widest range of disposals available mm-hmm. to them. And in terms of barriers, which you specifically mentioned, convener, right now, children below the age of 18 can indeed be placed in secure if they have been convicted of an offence. But of course, there are existing legal barriers. So the purpose of this bill is to ensure that all children under the age of 18, and that of course is the definition of a child for the purpose of this bill, in accordance with both the promise and the UNCRC, that a child is under the age of 18. And therefore, irrespective of their deeds, they should be able to be placed in secure accommodation, notwithstanding that when those children come of age, that they can then transfer to a young offenders institute and, depending on the length of their sentence, you know, progress into the adult system.
Mm-hmm. So would there be scope, do you think, for factors other than age to be considered in terms of that sort of placement process? So risk, perhaps, and that's something that is topical at the moment, the sort of nature of the crime, which to a certain extent I would imagine is already undertaken.
So, convener, you're quite correct, and obviously this committee will be aware of the work and the development of risk assessment tools, for example, by the Risk Management Authority. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It is based on evidence, and quite correct that the risk management tools for children have to be distinct from those for adults. The advantages of placing children, all children, in secure care where that where an offence has been committed, is the flexibility in secure accommodation to really be focused on those tailor-made individual assessments of need and risk. And because, I mean, committee will be aware of this, just because of the physical environment, in secure accommodation is smaller, it's more intense support, a more intensive way to address the risks and needs of children who are in conflict with the law. It is an area that providers of secure accommodation are already experts in. They have all been doing this for a number of years with a children who have committed a variety of offences. So I hope that helps to answer.
Thanks. Yes. No. That is helpful. Okay. I'm just going to bring in other members if anybody would like to kick things off. Pauline, I think you would like to come in and then Rona.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I'd like to welcome the Minister to your post. I think I've already done that already to the Cabinet Secretary. So I totally, wholeheartedly agree with your statement. I've raised issues in this Parliament where there have been horrible cases where people took their own lives because they should have been in secure accommodation. So let's be clear, this is something that I support. What I'm concerned about, and I wonder if you could address this, is how is the government going to achieve this? I mean, is there a plan? I mean, do you have a plan? If you have it, you know, given the very strong statement you made, how are you going to create the places and the funding to make this happen? And is there a sort of stepped approach to how, like, you know, this year, are you going to create so many additional places? I realise you can't do it in one go. But the only way that statement can have any validity is if you can tell the committee that you've got some plan, albeit, you know, incrementally, to reach the number of places that you would need. This has been a controversial issue in this Parliament for some time. I know Cabinet Secretary for Justice will be well aware how far back this goes, about the sensitivities around who's getting secure places. So this is the fundamental question that I do think needs to be addressed by government. If you could answer that, would be great. Thanks.
So I'll start with that, and the Minister may, of course, wish to come in later. I'll start with answering Ms McNeill's question, because I am aware of the history of this. Mm-hmm. It goes back many, many years, and it is imperative that we have the right provision at the right time, and that does, of course, require resources. And, you know, we need to be, you know, confident that going forward that we have the capacity to meet the needs of children that are being displaced, shifted from the criminal justice system into secure accommodation. So what we know is that in terms of the reduction, there's a reduction in young people, 16 and 17-year-olds, who are now receiving custodial sentences. So over the last decade or so, that's fallen by 93%. So we are, you know, talking about a comparatively small cohort of young people. Right now, the most recent figures that I have seen that are just a few days old, we have six under-18s currently impolement YOI, and there are currently 12 vacancies across the secure estate. But where I agree with Ms McNeill, where that this needs a real vigilant eye, is that absolute predictions about the circumstances in which a young person will go through the court system are always, you know, hard to predict. So I think we are starting from a good baseline, from a good position in terms of our understanding of you know, current capacity and the likely demand. And members, I don't need to repeat, you know, the financial memorandum and, you know, the work that underpins that. But I will add, highlight to members the work that we're doing around Secure Care Plus. And that's about ensuring that we have the correct contingency plans in place to ensure that in all circumstances that we can meet the needs of any child at any time within the establishment. It is a complex area. There are many issues about funding, as well as the work, that longer-term work being undertaken to reimagine the secure estate as well. But it is an area that I have an acute and will continue to keep a keen, very keen interest in. And I don't know, from the Minister, from her perspective, she may have some further things to add.
Yes, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm happy to add on to that, although the Cabinet Secretary gave a very thorough answer. I mean, broadly, the numbers do fluctuate, so it is kind of hard to give a definitive answer to this overall. But currently, there is capacity. There are currently 6 children in Young Offenders Institutes, and there are 14 beds available in secure care. So there is capacity just now, but as I said, that obviously can fluctuate. The financial memorandum took care not to underestimate the number of children on average to provide headroom for that in terms of going forward and these changes. At the moment, it should never be the case that any young person goes to a Young Offenders Institute because there isn't capacity. So that is something that obviously is going to be at the forefront going forward. And as the Cabinet Secretary noted, the reimagining secure care is looking into it.
So just so I'm clear about this, so what you're both saying at the moment is that based on looking at the under-18s that are in a Young Offenders Institution and you've got 12 vacancies, you're putting this, because that's not really been the case before. I know for certain that William Lindsay Brown didn't go to secure accommodation because there was no place. Mm-hmm. And he took his own life in Pullman on remand, which I want to ask you if a remand's included in this, in these circumstances. Is your position that it's the reduction, a policy change, if you like, that has resulted in the vacancies? I just wanted to be clear why that vacancies exist.
So I think there's a longer term trend in the reduction of 16, 17 year olds being incarcerated. Notwithstanding that, you know, last year there was, you know, nearly 1,000, you know, under 25s that still were still imprisoned. I suppose in terms of your specific points, there is some profile work going on looking at the under 25 population so that we can plan as much as mm-hmm. possible and try and anticipate future demand and expectation. There's obviously some work going on with Scotland Excel, who manage the current secure care contract, which is a change from when I was first aware of some of the issues from a government perspective in and around this.
Yeah, but sorry to interrupt, but I like to be clear when I get an answer that you're saying that it's a policy change that's resulted in a reduction in custodial sentences is the reason we've got 12 vacancies. Is that, have I understood that?
I suppose I was just giving you the backdrop as to, you know, I was giving you accurate information about the current situation, that today, you know, there are 12 vacancies in secure accommodation, and in Pullman today, you know, there are 6.
But I'm asking, why is that? And are you confident then that trend would continue? Because my first question to the Minister is, really what I'm trying to get at is have you planned adequately for your policy position, which I fully support? So if your evidence to the committee is, in fact, well, we've got a good starting point here because the policy trend is resulting in vacancies, so we can start here and then... So I just wanted to be clear.
So forgive me, I thought I had said in my original answer that we do have a good starting point, that we do have a good basis to go forward to.
But I'm asking why? Is it... That 93% reduction Is it a coincidence, or is it?
That 93% reduction in the number of 16, 17-year-olds that have been sentenced is due to work that has commenced over the last decade about shifting, young people into, alternative. Alternatives to prosecution or alternatives to custody where that is appropriate. Right. And that's about the whole systems approach to youth justice that commenced in 2011. But in terms of going forward, because I think where there's a reasonable point that is being made that if we are increasing the legal route for all children under 18 in the system to go into secure, that will of course increase demand on secure facilities. And I'm saying as of today, there are 6 young people under the age of 18 in Pullman and there are vacancies, but we need to be vigilant that there is always capacity. So some of the work around funding and the fact that right now the Scottish Government funds one bed in each of the 4 independent providers. And as you will see from the financial memorandum, that there are plans for the number of funded beds to increase. So that's part of the work about us ensuring that we've always got the right contingency arrangements in place, notwithstanding that there's further work going on, in particular with providers and multi-agency partners, to ensure that should we need the flexibility to put in additional support to any provider, that we are in a position to do that.
That's really helpful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Rona Mackay and then Katie Clark.
Thank you. Thanks, convener. Good morning, panel, and welcome both to your new posts. Cabinet Secretary, earlier you said you talked about the need for intensive support being given to young people going into secure care. Earlier in the private session, we heard that the opinion was from a care experienced person that there should be a mental health professional in every secure care setting permanently. And I just wondered if I could have your view on that. Is that something that you would envisage taking forward? And also the aspect of staff training for that. I wonder if I could have your view on that, please.
Well, I mean, obviously, this is stage one of a bill process. There are matters of how we amend and approve the legislation going forward, but there are also matters that are perhaps more about policy and practice. We are currently engaged with providers, with the sector, to ensure that the best possible care and support and supervision is given to young people going forward. There are questions about what is the best way to access ongoing mental health support for young vulnerable people. There are key issues about staff training. In my knowledge and experience, staff operating in the secure estate are very well trained and have a high skill base. But we, of course, want to ensure that people and children in particular can access the right treatment at the right time as well. And I'll give a commitment to looking closely at that evidence that committee's been provided, and obviously any subsequent recommendations that committee makes in its report.
Thank you. If I could just follow up with a question that, obviously, with the changing priorities, and which I fully support, there will be children who've committed more serious crimes being placed in secure care. And, that is that a cause for concern? And they'll obviously be in with younger, more vulnerable children. So I'm just wondering how that can be managed, and would suitable risk assessments be taken in that instance? And again, that would presumably require staff training to deal with the balance of that situation.
I suppose the starting position here is that the arrangements and the staff within the secure estate This is their bread and butter. They deal with children from a range of age groups. Primarily, it is, I mean, I think the latest figures I've seen is that the majority of children going into secure are, you know, at that older age group, 15, 16, 17. Staff already work with a high proportion of children who will have a history of the commission of assaults, or working with children who have a history of, you know, perhaps using or brandishing weapons. And they have that expertise already. And I think, you know, that should give us confidence, because irrespective of the route that children go into secure accommodation, whether that's via the criminal justice system, or whether it's the children's hearing system, whether they are on measures to do with their own care and protection, or indeed, you know, the care and protection of others, is that there is an overlap. There's a real similarity in terms of the history of adverse childhood experiences. 98% of children who appear at court will have a history of being in the children's hearing system, will have high levels of vulnerability. Children who, you know, whose destination is secure but via the children's hearing system, will also have, have had instances of conflict with the law. And the research undertaken by the Children and Young People Centre for Justice actually demonstrates that, you know, the risks and needs of children insecure, you know, are not dissimilar. Now, saying that, There are always exceptions, and that's why we need to have the contingencies and flexibilities going forward. Where with the work in and around Secure Care Plus, that should there need to be arrangements where we can quickly support and facilitate either additional staff or other additional intensive measures within a secure environment, or indeed adaptations to the property. You know, we need to be able to do that. But where secure has an advantage over prison care is its flexibility and its ability to respond to the individual needs, but also the individual risks presented by children. And staff who work in secure accommodation are well acquainted with addressing not just the needs of an individual child, but also in the context of the other children that they also have responsibility for.
Thank you. That's very reassuring. Did you want to say anything?
Yeah, again, that was a very thorough answer, but I just wanted to add, obviously, we know prisons are not places for children, and that's something that we've already discussed this morning. But we obviously do acknowledge that there are circumstances where people need protected from children who have caused harm. There are rigorous risk assessments involved with both the child itself and the people that the children that are already in the secure care centre. So that is something that we really want to emphasise. I guess I just wanted to add that the secure care centre is the most appropriate form, regardless of the gravity of the crime in that situation, because the secure care centre is going to be the nurturing environment that has the best chance of giving a child or a young person the chance to rehabilitate, the chance to change their path in life. And that's something that I think needs to be emphasised with this in comparison to older adults.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Convener. Okay.
Yeah. Thanks very much. I'll bring in Katie and then Fulton.
First of all, if I could maybe ask a question that's arisen from the evidence you've given so far, just so that I can be absolutely clear about why we need this legislation and why there's currently six young people in Pullmont. Is there a legal barrier to stop those young people being transferred into secure care at the moment?
Yes, that's my understanding, but I can, of course, conscious that Ms Clark, as a lawyer, that we may want to defer to officials on this. But
yeah, I'm more than happy to take that. So at the moment, in terms, and I'm sure Barry will come in and correct me if I'm wrong, given that he is the official lawyer in the room, at the moment, the 16 and 17-year-olds within the court, if they're prosecuted in court and they're under a compulsory supervision order, then they're deemed to be children, so the court can place them into secure care. But obviously there are 16 and 17-year-olds that are within the court environment that are not under a compulsory supervision order. Mm-hmm. And I don't think the provision exists at the moment to send them to secure care, so they would have to go to a YOI.
Thank you. I mean, I've not worked as a solicitor for many years, but I think what you're saying is because of the nature of the court disposal, it's not possible for the Scottish Government to transfer those children from Polmont into secure care. And that's why this legislation is required. So that's really helpful. That's clarified things for me. I've got a couple of questions, if that's all right. And I appreciate the Cabinet Secretary that she wishes the widest range of disposals to be available. And we know that secure care is very expensive. Can I say that I fully support what the government is trying to do here? But I was at the STUC Congress yesterday in Dundee, where there was a debate about the cuts in justice social work, and indeed the cuts more widely in terms of children's services. And the Cabinet Secretary has spoken, you know, about the need for resources. So, to what extent are alternatives available other than secure care, which, as we know, is very expensive, that may be less expensive but may involve some of the rehabilitation and support that both of the Cabinet Secretary and Minister have referred to? Earlier this morning, we spoke with two young women who have experienced both of the prison and secure care settings when they were 16 and 17 years old. And whilst we don't know everything about those individuals, particularly one of those women, it wasn't clear whether actually she should have been in that, you know, definitely she shouldn't have been in prison, but she was a care leaver. She'd basically been thrown out of care when she was 16, and we know that's happened to many, many young people. And I'm just wondering to what extent the justice system is being asked to step in due to failures in relation to, you know, responsibilities that are not the responsibility of the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, but the failure collectively to properly fund youth services, social work, and indeed to provide the support that the state should be providing to young people in care when they're over 16, so, you know, those leaving care. And I don't know if the Minister is better placed to answer that.
So I'll pick up mm-hmm. the point in and around community justice services. We invest in community justice services to the tune of £134 million. £123 million of that is ring-fenced for local authority criminal justice social work services. Again, some of that is ring-fenced around bail assessment and bail supervision, around £3 million. We invest in community justice services not because they're cheaper. I do acknowledge that prison is expensive mm-hmm. and that secure care is even more expensive, and that if we inappropriately use either secure care or prison, it is a very expensive mm-hmm. way of making matters worse. Mm-hmm. But we invest in community justice services not because they're cheaper, but because the evidence tells us that we should be investing in community justice services. Now, I'm not going to deny that there is pressure on the public pound. I think many of the challenges that local government are experiencing is what the Scottish Government is experiencing across the board. I'll never demur from the importance of investment. I suppose what I would point to is, you know, whilst acknowledging challenges, is that the local government settlement went up in real terms while there was a real terms reduction to the Scottish Government block grant. But I do recognise the pressures, and, you know, it does mean that we need to work even harder that shift in culture, shift in policy, shift in practice that is, you know, first and foremost based on the evidence, notwithstanding the investment in community justice services, you know, I can assure you will continue.
Can I just pick up on that? Because we know there's been real terms cuts in community justice, and I appreciate the points you're making. We also know it costs roughly about £40,000 a year to keep someone in prison. I know it depends on which prison, but you know, that was the broad brush figure we were given. We were told it's about four times as much to keep someone in secure care. And I just wonder why it is we haven't seen more significant shifts in budgets to put money into social work and community justice. I appreciate both the Cabinet Secretary and the Minister have just taken up their posts. I'm not holding them personally responsible, but there seems to be a disconnect between policy and where we're putting our money.
Well, I suppose I'd maybe point to some of the statistics that I quoted to Ms McNeill earlier, that, you know, we are seeing, you know, prosecutions of children and young people decrease, custodial sentences amongst young people decrease, you know, a decrease in referrals to the reporter on offence grounds. So that would point to something that we must be doing something right in and around supporting young people, both in terms of reducing reoffending you know, focusing on, you know, what's the best disposal for them and indeed for the community. There is, of course, always, you know, competing demands about shifting resource from, you know, acute care to community services. I mean, I think, you know, even if you're reducing, you know, a prison population, for example, you still need to have that establishment up and running. What I would point to is, and this is historical, and it's there for good reasons, is the ring fencing of criminal justice, social work funding. And I know that ring fencing isn't always a popular word, but that came about 20 years plus ago, because criminal justice services were not getting their fair share of resource, and because it's quite a small service in comparison to, say, you know, children and families community care services, it was being sidelined. And I will certainly want to protect the position of community justice services as well as community justice social work services.
And I'm not in any way doubting the Cabinet Secretary's personal commitment, but does she accept that there just hasn't been that structural shift that we need in resources
rehabilitation? I think I would always be candid and say that there is more to be done in that matter.
Okay. Definitely. So in terms of the resources issue, there's obviously been a great deal of media speculation around about the sentencing guidelines for under 25-year-olds, particularly in relation to very serious offences. And could the Cabinet Secretary perhaps outline the non-custodial disposals that are available, not particularly community service, because that doesn't necessarily have a rehabilitation element as such, but what is available in terms of support and rehabilitation that adequately focuses on trying to rehabilitate individuals who have committed very serious offences. Could she perhaps outline what is available to the courts?
So obviously in general terms.
In general terms.
I'll do that. So while and what in the old days we called community service, that was about, you know, a kind of fine on your time. But of course community service these days sits up in the broader panoply of a community payback order, and within a community payback order there can indeed be requirements for rehabilitation measures to be in place. We also have arrangements in and around electronic tagging and monitoring. There are also arrangements around sex offenders registration, you know, MAPA, public protection arrangements, and also in some instances court can ask for report backs to review a situation. So there is a range of disposals and approaches that are available to the court. And some of those rehabilitative measures can, of course, be intensive, whether that's one-to-one work or group work.
OK, thank you.
Thank you very much. Thornton, followed by Russell.
Thanks, Convener. And we'll take this opportunity to welcome both the Minister and the Cabinet Secretary formally to their new positions. And thanks to the Minister for that earlier statement at the start of the session. My question, my first question is following on a bit from the conveners. I'm very supportive of this, as are the stakeholders, as you'll be aware. But I'm wondering what, and I know maybe jumping ahead a wee bit here because we're putting through the legislation at the moment for 18, but I'm keen to hear where the government stand in terms of this being a starting point, 18 being a starting point, because I think a lot of the evidence that we've heard, including the evidence that we heard privately today, which was really powerful from two individuals, is that, you know, 18 is still very young, as is, you know, 21, 25. So I just wonder if there's any thoughts, maybe the Minister first, in terms of where the government might see this going.
Thank you very much for your question. Yeah, absolutely. Obviously, that is a little bit in the future. So the bill focuses, as you've rightly said, on under 18. So the bill focuses on children under the age of 18 because that is what is in line with UNCRC. But we absolutely recognise that children under the, or people under the age of 25 are still developing. And in many areas, I think Scotland has and is still developing a very distinct approach to young people aged between 18 and 25 years of age. But I think the considerations at the moment for under-18s are very different, particularly in terms of rights. So, for example, the bill makes provisions for young people to remain in secure care, having been sentenced or remanded before the age of 18 until 19. But that will only be a possible when the approach isn't contrary to the best interests of other children. But as we look at young... Sorry, to get back to your question, as we look at young adults over the age of 18, the number of people and the offences who would be affected by a different approach massively increases, as you've seen from the numbers in terms of those who would be in secure care currently in YOIs. In previous evidence sessions, I know that witnesses were broadly supportive of this bill being a kind of starting point to look at beyond that scope of beyond 18. And we're also mindful of the Sheriff Mackey Hearing System Working Group, which is Children's Hearing Redesign, which is yet to report. So I think these wider developments will provide us with evidence base and valuable learning, and then we can look to that in the future, certainly. But at the moment, Young Offenders Institutes will continue to provide custodial facilities for those up to age 23. But absolutely take your point that this is definitely something that we need to look at going forward.
So just to briefly add to that, Mr. McGregor, the children's hearing system can't operate after a child's 18th birthday other than by exception. So therefore, you know, there will continue to be a need for young offenders institutions. And again, by exception, young people can, at the discretion of the Governor, remain in a YOI till they're 23 before transferring to the adult prison. I think given the Inspectorate of Prisons' view on the inappropriate nature of young offenders institutions for children, I think if children are no longer committed to young offenders institutions, that will give us, you know, some opportunities to look at the, you know, the care and the support within young offenders institutions. Because I'm also aware of the review in and around mental health in young offenders in institutions as well. So I think, you know, going forward, I think there are improvements that can be made in various custodial establishments. But there is no plans to be removing young offenders institutions because, you know, secure care
other than with the exceptions the Minister has outlined, you know, applies for children up to the age of 18.
And you've already, Cabinet Secretary, preempted my next question then, because I was thinking, one of the things that we spoke about with stakeholders, I think it was the last session, was as part of the answer, do you think possibly young offenders institutes being more modelled on secure settings? Is that, do you think that could potentially in the future, I know there would obviously be resourcing issues, but given that I think the impression of secure care is a very positive one, do you think that the Young Offenders Institutes could be more modelled on the secure setting, is that a potential answer to that question?
So actually, where I would draw parallels with is with some of the innovations and changes that have been made in the women's estate, yeah. I think are probably a better comparator in that we've seen in the women's estate you know, significant moves towards trauma and foreign practice, you know, within a custodial setting, and the new women's national facility, you know, will open in the summer, and we have already seen the establishment of two smaller units for women, one in Dundee, which I visited recently, and the one in Glasgow. Now, you know, I'm not. I am conscious of the resource questions that members have already raised, but I do think that there is an opportunity to actually think about the type of care, support and rehabilitation and opportunities to better address reoffending within the context of a custodial environment.
Yeah, thanks for that, Cabinet Secretary. That does sound very positive. Just one final question, if that's all right, Convener. Probably for yourself, Minister, and that's around, I think Ronan Mackay began to touch on it. Do you think there's a wee bit of work that needs to be done around with the public, around what secure care is? I mean, in terms of yourself and your officials, you'll know that the committee members here will know, people that work in the sector will know, but I think there's possibly a perception that, you know, secure care is somewhat a softer touch, whereas if MDs knows MD has been in secure care or dealt with that, knows that the person still very much loses their liberty. It is not a soft touch for the young person or individual. We actually heard that again today in the private session. So it's definitely a lot more therapeutic, a lot more beneficial, and it seems to be best for young people. Do you think there is a job of work to be done there in terms of communicating that to the public so that it's not seen as almost soft justice or whatever you want to call it?
Yeah. We certainly don't want to give that impression anyway. Secure care is without doubt the most intensive and restrictive form of care that there is in Scotland. I mean, I've visited a centre myself where it's a place where a child is deprived of liberty, as a member stated, in a locked environment alongside at the same time the provision of care, support and education. I mean, when a child is placed in secure care, public protection and safety is to the absolute forefront. The child is cared for in a locked facility, and in the longer term, as the child is provided with support to aid their rehabilitation, reintegration. And I guess that comes back to what I was saying earlier. It's about finding that balance between the restrictions and the reduction of liberty, but also that nurturing environment that where 16 and 17-year-olds who could have committed those offences have the chance to rehabilitate themselves in an appropriate setting. So there may be more work that needs done around sort of conveying that image, but they're definitely not a soft touch.
And as well as conveying that, image to the public, to the judiciary, to the sheriffs, do you think that needs to be done, or do you think that they are there with that? Maybe more for the Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah. I don't mean to sound, you know, dispassionate in any way. I think the important issue here is about what does the evidence tell us? What does the evidence tell us about what will work in the rehabilitation of people who've came into conflict with the law, and therefore what works in terms of, you know, improving, you know, community safety. I'm of the view that, you know, whether it's
society or whether it's members of the judiciary or, you know, members of the public, that the people are able to, well able to engage in that debate and to engage in that debate based on the facts. So it's really, you know, important, I think, particularly when we are dealing with sensitive and very emotive issues where there is, of course, you know, great public interest in. And I think it's important that we always have the courage to talk about what the evidence tells us and what is going to work in, you know, rehabilitating young people or indeed other offenders, and how that will improve community safety. And that's why, you know, there's, you know, that this legislation is important, but it sits in the context of a wider refocusing of justice policy.
Thank you. Thanks to both.
Okay. Thank you. Russell Findlay, and then I'll bring in Jackie.
Thanks very much, and congratulations to you both on your new appointments. Now, in the last session, we heard evidence that secure accommodation costs something like four times as much as prison, and that Scotland has got 84 secure places currently, with the largest of these being, or the largest provider of these being, St Mary's. Now, Jim Shields of St Mary's said that funding right now was precarious and it needs certainty, whereas Professor Lorraine Johnson said that at times the St Mary's relied on cross-border placements to be sustainable, with some English local authorities paying 35% more than the Scottish Government pays. In the eventuality and the likelihood of more secure accommodation being needed, do you have any projection on how much more will be needed, how much it will cost, and whether the financial memorandum has properly factored in the concerns being expressed in that last session?
So it is important just to highlight to committee that over and above the financial memorandum, that there is a national resources group here, because some of these issues do need unpicked further. I'll come on separately to talking about the cross-border transfer issue, but I would recognise that there is a need for a very clear pathway going forward, and that over and above the issues detailed in the financial memorandum, that we are engaging intensively with stakeholders on this. My understanding from work that Scotland Excel have done is that there is capacity within the system to meet Scotland's needs. So if you remove the cross-border transfers, just for argument's sake, we have the capacity here in Scotland to meet our needs now and what they are expected to be in the future, notwithstanding that we could get further information and that could change. In terms of, and I've also pointed to the beds that we are now funding, and that came off the back of a pilot, and I think I mentioned earlier, convener, that the number of beds within the estate in terms of Scottish Government funding you know, will increase to ensure that we have that stability and certainty.
So the number of beds rising from 84, is that?
Sorry?
Are the number of beds being increased?
Well, I suppose that the point I'd made, I mean, I wouldn't rule that out for sure, but the point I made that if you discount cross-border transfers, that in terms of the prediction work that Scotland, in terms of the work that Scotland Excel have done, looking at you know, the numbers of children that have been in YOIs over the years and the number of children in secure care.
So the cross-border stuff's removed from the equation, Scotland's got enough capacity. But that then brings into play the problem of the cost, because these cross-border places are paying 35% more. Scottish Government will therefore have to find that money to fund those places at a higher rate, will they not, to make St Mary's and others sustainable?
There's an important point about the financial stability of the secure sector going forward. We know, for example, that they need to be at 90% capacity to, you know, that's their financial stability vector, if you like. So the system has capacity for Scotland just now. But because of the reliance, if you like, on cross-border transfers, that's why we have started to fund beds, and there are plans for us to increase the funding of beds so that we can ensure that for children who are resident in Scotland, that they can be cared for and secure if that's required.
Thank you. Now, we also heard evidence from Victim Support Scotland in the previous session who say that victims of crime, often young people, are really surprised by the lack of information, and they described it as an information vacuum. So that is when cases go not to courts, which at least are public, but to the children's panel system. There was a particular case that's been well publicised recently in which a young girl was severely beaten by another young person. This young person was subject to bail conditions, but these had been lifted or removed without the person's knowledge or the police's knowledge, causing great distress, understandably. So I just wonder if the bill, if there's any consideration being given into more transparency around the greater number of cases that are likely to go to children's panels, and if that's not even public, whether it could be something that should be informed of towards the victims and their families, what work or consideration has been given into that?
So as far as possible, we want to have a parity between systems as much as possible, notwithstanding that the children's hearing system is fundamentally about addressing the needs of children as opposed to punishment. And in terms of this bill, it actually extends the it increases the obligation on the principal reporter, who now has a duty as opposed to a discretion to inform victims of their right to receive information, and that could be about the fact that a hearing has taken place, and also to inform the victim about the outcome of the hearing as well. Obviously, for young people that are progressed through the criminal justice system, there is the current victim notification system. What I would say, so while this, I would contend that this very specific bill you know, increases the rights and protections for victims, it isn't our only intervention in this area. Mr Finlay, is aware that we have undertaken other consultations in and around things like what else can we do within the broader system to ensure that victims' needs are met. And also we've consulted on things such as Victims Commissioner. So we are actively engaged in what we need to do to enhance the rights of victims. And of course there will be other, going forward, there are other policies and legislation that will also help to address this matter.
But this bill potentially could include the right or the requirement of the Children's Panel to inform victims of outcomes.
So what the bill as it stands right now is that it places a duty on the principal reporter. Just now he or she has some discretionary powers, but this bill puts a duty on the principal reporter where they have the information on the victim and contact details, etc. And I appreciate that isn't always the case, but where the principal reporter has, you know, sufficient information on a victim, that the principal reporter can contact the victim and advise them of their rights to receive information, whether they would wish to receive information and the type of information that they, you know, would be entitled to receive if the victim so wishes, is the notification that, you know, a hearing is taking place and also the outcomes of that hearing. And let me just check with officials and the lawyer that I have articulated accurately how the bill currently stands. For Mr Finlay's interest.
Yes, I can just confirm that under Section 179B of the Children's Hearing Scotland Act 2011, it's enshrined that the information that's potentially available to victims is information about the determinations in relation to the system, including whether a compulsory supervision order has been made or any other action in connection with the case.
Okay,
so that's a starting point from the current framework.
Right, thank you. We have time for one more? Yeah. Oh, great, okay. So there's certain young people, and I know these cases are incredibly rare, but certain young people do commit extremely serious crimes. I think back to one not so long ago in which a 16-year-old raped and murdered a 6-year-old girl. Now, in a case like that, that individual would be sent to secure accommodation. And I just wonder if there's an acceptance that sometimes in these most rare of cases, extreme cases, that is not appropriate, and whether the bill should have something, some kind of mechanism that would allow for those kinds of cases.
So in these gravest of offences, the Crown Office and the Lord Advocate, you know, as they do on any case, have, you know, prosecutorial independence. And in gravest of cases where the young person is progressed through the criminal justice system, and as can happen in these gravest of cases, that hefty custodial sentences are handed down, what this actually means in practice is that if that young person was 16, that they would spend the first few years of their sentence in secure, progress to a young offenders institute, and then to a prison. I suppose what I would want to convey is that secure accommodation is, given the levels of security and the intensive nature of the supervision, as well as the other inputs, is an appropriate place for all child offenders who require secure accommodation. It doesn't mean that they won't, of course, go on to serve the remainder of their sentence in the adult sector.
Because the bill allows for them to remain within secure accommodation until, what age is that, 19 or is it 21?
So if that's considered to be, so by and large, it's 18, that is the norm. If, and this would apply to all children in secure accommodation and not just children who have committed the gravest of offences, that if it was considered to be in their best interest without conflicting with the interests of other children, that is an option for the people most closely involved in their care and supervision to come to a view on.
So, going back to the original answer, it's an absolute, as far as the bill stands, anyone under a certain age.
So the promise, and the UNCRC commitments that the government has made, and of course there's cross-party support of both the promise and implementing the promise, and also cross-party support in terms of meeting our obligations under the United Nations Charter for the Rights of the Child, and for us to meet those commitments, is that all children who have offended and where a custodial disposal is required, if they're under 18 in the first instance, they would go to secure accommodation.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, and take this opportunity to welcome you both to your new roles also. I was at the private session earlier on today, and I agree with Fulton McGregor, it was really, really powerful. And some of the things that was discussed, I'll be quite frank and honest, I didn't even consider them. And one of them, one of the young ladies was saying how daunting she found it after coming out of secure accommodation to be put into a flat, that, to realise that she didn't have the basic
life skills, you know, of maybe how to even put on a washing machine or pay a bill, which is something that most people wouldn't even think about. And she says purely down to because the care system did it for her while she was in the secure accommodation. So can I ask you, what is being done to ensure that our young folk are getting the basic life skills that they need once they leave secure accommodation?
Well, of course, secure accommodation is about providing support and interventions on the broadest range of matters. It is about providing age-appropriate, you know, holistic support and for children who are being prepared to be reintegrated into the community post a secure placement, that indeed should be taking place. It's also very important that the proper aftercare arrangements are in situ as well. It's also worth bearing in mind that you know, there are a number of children who, you know, perhaps, you know, go to secure and it may be for quite a short period of time as well. So therefore, it's really important that for those children who, you know, are not, you know, they're not spending 2-3 years in secure as part of a longer sentence, that the planning for their return to the community, that should commence on admission. But it is a very live issue, I suppose, irrespective of where a young person is placed, if they are deprived of their liberty. And it also applies to adult prisoners as well, for people who are destined to be released, that, you know, we need to be setting them up for success on liberation and not setting them up to fail. But I'll check if the Minister has anything else to add on this.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Yeah, just very quickly, it's just to make clear that this bill means that if children are placed in secure care, then they will be treated as looked after children, and they, as a result of that, they will be entitled to local authority support in terms of aftercare and some of the things that you referred to.
Okay, thank you very much. And just quickly as well, something that they also said to us was that sometimes that when they were put into police cells, and they found that was the most traumatic bit about it, because they were suddenly shut in by themselves and there was very or little no support. So I guess my question would be, are we going to have any consideration to find out if that's appropriate for children to be put there in the first instance, or are we thinking of maybe finding a perhaps a better situation for them to be put in?
So the use of police custody is a really important factor. It's important to state that in terms of a place of safety, this bill doesn't change the definition of a place of safety, and other than by exception where it's necessary and proportionate and to avoid further harm, a police station wouldn't be considered a place of safety. So what this bill does, in terms of the provision that currently exists for children under 16, in terms of the safeguards about what should happen should they be in a police station, bearing in mind, you know, a police station can be a very frightening, distressing environment, particularly for a child, that those provisions that currently exist for under 16s can be extended, or will be extended, to children under 18. And that's about constable or desk sergeant in charge. You know, they have particular procedures to follow. It's around, you know, notifying a parent or another appropriate suitable adult, but also crucially liaising with the local authority as well, because the local authority might have information that's germane to the care and treatment of a child under 18 as well. Is there anything the Minister would want to add?
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Very briefly, we actually published a list of places of safety in February, and this was further to the Age of Criminal Responsibility Act. So each local authority identified their own resources areas. This could have included foster care, children's houses. So that is something that's already underway.
So even if they're picked up for... I'm trying to word myself... You know, if the police are going to charge them with something, that they could still maybe go to a foster home rather than a police cell. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Yep. Thanks very much. I wonder if I can maybe just pick up on the issue of. Children coming into police custody, because obviously we've spent quite a bit of time looking at the issues around secure accommodation. And I just wondered if, in terms of children coming into police custody, whether regardless of what time of day that might be, I mean, I know how difficult it is for custody sergeants and custody officers to care for young people and meet their needs if you've got a busy custody centre and there are quite a lot of issues and challenges already in place. Is it the case to say perhaps that children should, regardless of the crime type or offence that they've been admitted for, should just not be detained in a police station under any circumstances? And could that potentially be on the face of the bill? Now, I know that might have quite significant practical implications in terms of how you make provision for an alternative place of safety, but I'd just be interested in your views on that.
So I mean, I think it's fair to say that a place of safety is always preferable to a police station. Mm-hmm. What I would want to avoid is, you know, police officers feeling stuck in a particular situation that, you know, that they're not, that they end up not taking a young person to a police station because you know, they're not just worried about it not being suitable, but, you know, so that it then leads to some maybe, you know, even more risk averse practice, when currently there is, you know, provision that allows, you know, where it's necessary, proportionate, where it's, you know, maybe would be impractical or unsafe or inadvisable, you know, for someone not to be taken to a police station. It is an area that we are having live engagement on. So, in particular with the SPA, committee may be aware that there was a Child in Conflict with the Law conference last year, and this was a particular issue where there was a lot of focused attention on. So, you know, what I can say to committee is that I'm certainly, from my, you know, portfolio interest, really keen that we give this some further thought. Don't know if there's any necessarily quick and easy solutions in terms of the passage of this bill, but, you know, we're just really at the beginning of the process for this bill. And I know that there is interest in things like multi-agency care settings for children that are in conflict with the law as well. But I suppose just what I'm trying to convey to the convener and committee that it is, you know, definitely an area that we need to have some more focused activity and thinking on.
Mm-hmm. That's very good to hear, because, I mean, like you, I'm very interested in the process of children coming into custody, and I know that where that can be avoided and an alternative option utilised, then I'm pretty confident Police Scotland use those alternative routes. And it's interesting to hear about the conference focusing on that particular issue. I wonder if I can also just continue with another couple of questions. Just going back to points that other members have made around, and I think Fulton MacGregor, you picked it up around the provision within the bill that secure care is the default for under 18s, but this is a starting point. I'm just interested in whether one of the factors why the Scottish Government isn't yet extending that provision to 18 to 20 year olds, for example, is because if you look at that cohort of young people in terms of offenders, if you like, there are, as I understand it, currently over 150 held, so 18 to 20 year olds held in prison, as opposed to five held in prison who are aged 16 to 17. So that clearly would have very significant implications for resourcing and physical accommodation being available. So I'm just interested to know if that might be challenging, or if the government can commit to looking at broadening out the age range that comes into secure care going forward.
So I think we need to be really crystal clear on this point. Now, notwithstanding, I think we need to, look at issues of reform in and around young offenders institutions. But in terms of 16, 17-year-olds, what is happening here is that they are being moved from the criminal justice system into the children's hearing system, albeit for some of those children that will just be, on a temporary basis for, the purposes of their care while they're 16 and 17. But the children's hearing system is for children up to the age of 18. Mm-hmm. And I think while there would perhaps be approaches or interventions or work that is done with young people in a secure setting, that there could indeed be learning for that in an adult setting, I do think we need to be clear that that this notion of extending secure accommodation that is for children into meeting the needs of offenders who are adults is not an option. Mm-hmm. And I think there are a number of legal issues around that, as well as physical issues as well. That does not mean that we need to be constantly reviewing and challenging ourselves on the care of other young people within young offender institutions. And hence, the work around refocusing the use of custody for adults, as well as the need to be focused and improve, whether it's mental health support or opportunities to reduce reoffending and, tackle the issues in and around the heavy use of remand that we have in Scotland. But I do think we need a clear line.
Yeah. Thank you. And I think it also maybe goes back to the discussion that we had earlier around individualised placement, risk assessment, if you like. So there are some caveats to what you've very clearly articulated, just given some of the evidence that witnesses previously shared with us around that need to consider maturity and other factors in an individual when considering placement. Thank you. Any other questions at all before we finish? No, I think that just brings us almost up to time. Yeah. Rona.
Thank you. Just a brief question. I'm just wondering what consideration or assessment has been made of young people with learning difficulties who will not... The age threshold perhaps won't apply. Is that an individual assessment then?
So that may well be a very important factor in considering whether a young person should remain in secure care post their 18th birthday up to their 19th birthday. There are, of course, broader issues in other legislation that addresses what is the most suitable disposal for somebody with a learning disability. So there are obviously issues for a child or any person with a learning disability that is engaging with the court system, where there are issues around, you know, capacity. So there is a broader issue, but in terms of secure care, it may be a factor in enabling a young person to stay, you know, longer than their 18th birthday up to their 19th. Mm. But again, that is an individualised assessment on the needs of that children and the other children within the establishment.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I think we've got a final question from Russell.
Yes, thank you. I didn't realise we had time, but there was evidence in the last session about those young people who are in police custody under the age of 18. What the bill suggests, or what the bill would do, is give them the option for no parental contact to be made. And I just wondered whether, and I'd asked a question about this in the last session, whether any consideration would be given towards those children potentially being subject to exploitation, whether it be by someone who's not got their best interests at heart or organised crime, and whether the bill might have any way of addressing that.
So I understand why Mr Finlay is asking that question. It is, I suppose, the raison d'etre why current provision that's been extended to under 18s requires the notification of the local authority, who may well have information about that young person's background, so that they are able to highlight to the police issues of vulnerability. But it's certainly an issue that I would be happy to engage on in terms of, you know, safeguard, and it is in the context of the evolving capacity and rights of young people as they get older. But the Minister may also have some thoughts of her own on this too.
Sure, absolutely. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Yeah, it's of the utmost importance that we ensure that an inappropriate or unsafe person wasn't being contacted under the bill's provisions. When a child is in police custody, if aged under 16, their parent must be informed, or if aged 16 or 17, as the member has rightly stated, an adult reasonably named by the child. Now, existing safeguards enable an appropriate constable to delay sending information for various reasons, and that's including if this information is deemed necessary to safeguard and to promote the well-being of the child in custody. And the local authority as well would always be notified that a child is under 18, is in police custody, and can advise a constable that the person to whom information is to be sent, i.e. a parent or another adult, should not be sent to the child. The local authority can then give advice as to who might be an appropriate person, and the constable must have contact with this advice. An access of a parent or another adult to the child can also be refused or restricted should the constable believe that this is necessary to safeguard and promote the well-being of that child in custody. So this is something that the bill does take account for.
I'm glad to ask. The answer was all ready for me, so thank you. Brilliant.
Well, I had a feeling.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. OK, well, that just brings us pretty much up to time. So I'd like to thank you all for attending today. And we'll just now have a very short suspension to allow our witnesses to leave. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, members. So our next item of business is consideration of correspondence that we've received from the Scottish Government on access to court transcripts. And I refer members to paper 3. And I'd like to open it up to members for any comments that you have on the correspondence at all. So, Russell? Yeah.
Yeah. I suppose it's reassuring that in one of his last acts in post, Keith Brown's instructed a pilot to look into the possibility of providing court transcripts to at least complainers in sexual offences cases initially. So that's a good bit of progress. Mm-hmm. And I suppose we need to not lose sight of that and just ensure that what's been committed to is going to be put into action and quite quickly, and as long as we're clear as to what's happening.
Absolutely. I mean, I think we would all welcome the fact that the pilot has been proposed, which is very much a step in the right direction for us. Any other comments anyone wants to make, Rona?
I mean, just to say that totally welcome it. It's definitely a step in the right direction, and I think we should let Rape Crisis Scotland and Scottish Women's Aid and Victim Support know, because they've been quite concerned about this. I think it'll be important information for them.
No, that's probably a very good suggestion. Anybody else at all? If not, you'll note in the paper that there's a suggestion in terms of our follow-up action. So I think we're all very much agreed that we welcome the moves to explore the possibility of a pilot to support access to transcripts for complainers in sexual offences cases. And it might be, I think the one thing I do want to maybe just highlight is whether or not it would be feasible for a pilot and for a pilot to be perhaps delivered as part of or certainly incorporated into the criminal, into the committee's stage one consideration of the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill, which is due for introduction shortly. And as you quite rightly flag, Rona, we can obviously share correspondence appropriately with external organisations. So again, I would just open it up to views on that. Are members happy to agree? Rona?
Thanks, Convener. Just, unless I've missed it, I'm not sure when it starts and how long it will last. From this correspondence?
I think you're right. I think we haven't got that detail yet, but we can certainly ask for some more detail in and around that. So are members happy with the actions as they're set out in the paper, and we can follow that up? Yep. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, that concludes our public items, and we will now move into private session. Thank you.